BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. Today we're going back to the year 2003, when we saw a conviction in the case of Fred Lane, and more specifically, his murder. Now, Fred Lane was a running back for the Carolina Panthers, and he was supposed to be kind of continuing his career with the Indianapolis Colts, but things were, of course, cut short because he was murdered by his own wife. This is a case that I'd wanted to talk about for a while, because out of just pure curiosity, and like I wanted to learn more about it. And of course, you know, as a football fan growing up, this was something that kind of left an impact on me. I really got into watching the NFL in about 1998, I think it was the 1998 season, and we were talking about the NFL yesterday with some of the sports conspiracies and things like that. But this is one that I had remembered because it was one of the first times that, you know, somebody that I was somewhat familiar with was, well, murdered. I mean, after the Kansas City Chiefs linebacker Derek Thomas died in a car crash, and it was really, like, not in the car crash that killed him, some complications at the hospital, I just remember just being so shocked, like, somebody that I had looked up to and admired and, you know, someone that I was just familiar with had passed away. That was the first time a celebrity death really affected me. And then hearing something like Fred Lane, who was a running back for the Carolina Panthers, at least that's how I knew him, as well as the rest of America did, he was murdered. And I was like, oh my gosh, you know, it's just like, you know, I was like only 9 or 10 years old, maybe 11, and I don't know, it just always kind of left an impact on me or something. And I had wanted to talk about this on the channel, but yesterday, as I mentioned during our upload on Tasha Fields, sometimes you got to talk about the cases that might not be the most popular, but it's just things that you want to know more about and things that you want to explore. And the murder of Fred Lane has a lot of twists and turns, because we cannot have this discussion without only talking about Fred Lane and, you know, his football career. I mean, he was a good running back. He only had 2,001 total career yards. I thought it was actually an interesting number, just 2,001 rushing yards as a running back. But he averaged 4 yards a carry, scored 13 touchdowns. He could have gone on to do more things in the NFL. And, you know, it's first we have to say rest in peace, but it's like you cannot continue this discussion without introducing his wife, Deidre Lane. Now, Fred Lane was shot twice with a shotgun while he was walking into his home. He put the keys in the lock, and as he fell dead, the keys just remained there. His wife shot him once in the back of the head and once in the chest. And the defense was trying to say that she was the victim of abuse, that she had been a battered woman. But then they're like, I mean, in any sort of passion-provoked thing, shooting him twice, you know, at a very close range, what on earth could be going on with that? And the biggest thing that surrounded this case was people thought that Deidre Lane was trying to collect a $5 million insurance policy. Well, some of that might be true, but the story gets a little bit messier because, you know, lawyers are able to do lots of things, right? And there's a big thing we have to say at the end, so stay tuned. And it's like Deidre Lane was sentenced and convicted on the charge of voluntary manslaughter. And I was on the site, you know, Black Sports Online, BSO, one site that I'd never really checked out before. But they were talking about something when they were just sort of saying that, like, people have served less time in prison. I mean, people have served more time in prison for robbing gas stations than what she got. 7.5 years. 7.5 years. People have served more time for robbing a gas station. She was sentenced to 7.5 years in prison, and she was allowed to use her time served previously. Once again, she was sentenced in 2003, so that means that she could be released in 2009. And that's exactly what happened. Deidre Lane was released from prison in 2009, and she started a kids camp, like a kids summer camp, as a form of, like, you know, as a charity thing and just way to kind of continue her life. And so many people were just like, well, you know, she is a felon. Has she really been rehabilitated? I mean, supposedly she murdered her husband for insurance money, right? And then she is like, now wants to work with kids, and no one really seems to kind of like wants to bat an eyelash or something. What really is going on there? But this story takes an even darker turn in 2019. Like I said, I was just trying to read up on this one because it's something that I'd wanted to learn more about. And there actually is a recent development in this year right now. Right now it's November 2019. In September of 2019, Deidre Lane goes back to prison. I mean, she gets arrested again, and it involves complications as, like, being an accessory to bank robbery, of all things. This is the wife of Fred Lane, the woman who murdered him, shot him twice with a shotgun. She's back in prison because she is involved with a bank robbery. But who is the other person involved with the bank robbery? An individual named John Gary, her own brother. And when I said, though, that you guys should stay tuned for something and there's a little bit of a twist, it turns out that the possible motivation for the murder of Fred Lane was not even the insurance policy money. Maybe that was something that Deidre Lane had been thinking about, but it's possible that that was not even the motivation for her to murder him. John Gary, her brother, had a very big history of robberies and just illegal behavior. And in 1998, there was a robbery at a Wachovia bank, and just over $40,000 was stolen, which I think is very low for a bank robbery. I mean, somebody robbed a bank in my hometown, and they said that he was in and out in under 60 seconds, and he had nearly $1 million with him. $40,000 is very low for what you would pull out from a bank robbery, but I mean, you know, it's not like there's a rule book or something that the teller has to put in a certain amount of money in your bag and say, get the fuck out, or something like that. It's like, so there's a robbery at this Wachovia bank in North Carolina, and they actually believe that there was also some connection to Deidre Lane with this, that she had a connection to this bank robbery, and that Fred Lane, the man who she murdered, her husband, wanted to go to the police, or he didn't want anything to do with this. And, you know, he's a professional athlete. He still had his career ahead of him. He didn't want anything to do with this. He was going to go to the police about it and kind of rat her out, in other words. So that was the motivation for her to murder him, because he had knowledge and information about her connection to her brother's bank robbery. It seems the situation is somewhat a little unclear about her definitive connections to this back in 1998, but she was definitely an accessory to bank robbery in 2019, as you see that she's going to be back in prison. So this is a case where it just goes to show you that some people cannot shake the past. Some people cannot get out of these destructive spirals, and we see this time and time again, especially when we're dealing with some of the lesser-known true crime cases. Like, I mean, we mentioned the case of Tasha Fields that we were talking about yesterday, where just when someone gets involved in some sort of criminal activity, they just can't break the cycle. Another case that I had wanted to talk about on this channel that we haven't mentioned before is the case of Brittany Stewart, someone from Erie County, Pennsylvania, who was involved with the death of two toddlers, and she just couldn't really ever get out of the cycle of destructive behaviors. Some people get second chances in life. Some people get opportunities to get away from their problems, but they cannot shake them. And I mean, look at Deidre Lane. She was married to an NFL running back. She was definitely going to be involved with things like financial security, but other people pulled her into some destructive behavior, and it didn't seem like she was trying too hard to resist. I'm not a mind reader or something, but it didn't seem like she was trying too hard to stay away from this problematic lifestyle, especially brought on to her by her brother, John Gary. So this just goes to show you, the life of crime is hard to get out of, it's hard to escape, and there are people that are trying to pull you in. I think it was Jamie Foxx who said this. I think it was at like one of these award shows or something. I think it was Jamie, but I'm not really sure. I saw this ages ago. He said something when it was like, do not spend time with people who have nothing to lose, because they will lose your shit for you. And that's just exactly what it seems like happened to Deidre Lane. Once again, what on earth would she have to do with any sort of bank robbery if she didn't have to back in 1998? She's married to an NFL superstar. Even if she divorces him or something, she's probably going to get something and would never have to work a day in her life. Especially if, I mean, why, I can't even really go down that road of her possibilities. If she had done this, if she had done that. The fact of the matter is, she murdered Fred Lane, and he ended up dead in the ground, and she kind of went to prison multiple times, couldn't get away from the cycle of destructive behaviors. I first found out about Fred Lane because I was actually given a, it was a Christmas gift that I had, like a box of 330 football cards. It was something that I had asked for. Once again, like I said, I was 9 or 10 years old, really into the NFL, and I just wanted to learn everything about it. And the running back that everyone was talking about in Carolina was an individual named Tisamunga Biakabatuka. I hope I said his name right. I don't think I did. No one else ever could. So, but he was the kind of guy that everyone was focusing in on the time. This was way before Christian McCaffrey. And it's like, then I also found this card from some guy named Fred Lane. And I was like, huh, Carolina has another running back? And then I wanted to learn more about, just a little bit about the Panthers. And I wanted to see Fred Lane play. Because, you know, I had his card. Wanted to learn about his statistics. I mean, I just wanted to know more about football, all of them. And then, you know, I always remembered Fred Lane. And as I said, I saw some of the details about his murder on television. And at a young age, you learn that just the world is a nasty place. And, you know, I was someone who grew up watching Cops and America's Most Wanted every Saturday night. I mean, it's not unheard of, the cases of murder and such. But, like, when someone, you know, like, that you are somewhat familiar with, that, like, a famous person that, you know, you watched on television playing football ends up murdered, then you're like, holy crap, you know, it just gets a little bit more real. The death of Steve McNair, the former quarterback for the Tennessee Titans, was somebody that I also had some of that feeling with. He was also murdered as well, also by gunshot. That was actually from, I mean, his mistress, for lack of a better term. I wish I had a better way to describe that. And we might do something about Steve McNair, but with the case of Fred Lane and Deidre Lane, you can really see that this is one that did not have to happen. This was definitely a money, sex, power thing. Mostly money and power. And, I mean, it's a very dark twist that it wasn't about insurance money. And just look at what they did, though, with the justice system. 7.5 years, voluntary manslaughter for shooting her husband 2 times with a shotgun. I mean, that's what they're saying. There's no possibility this could be a defensive thing. There's no possibility that this could be sort of anything like passion provoked in the heat of the moment. Because if that were the case, she would have shot him 1 time. They're like, no, she shot him once in the chest and once in the back of the head. Very much trying to determine that he was dead, trying to make sure that he was dead, trying to kill him. And the judge even said that this was done in a premeditated manner. So it's like, this is one of the things that was just kind of a disgusting story that takes a couple dark twists and turns. And it's also kind of something where we need to re-examine the justice system and wonder, why do some people get off so easily? Well, that's all we have to say for our mini-upload today. We're going to be talking about some other stuff later on, but right now we're just going to leave it there with the death of Fred Lane. And I would just like to say once again, rest in peace, Fred Lane. And all we can say is that let's hope for a better tomorrow. Well, that's all for me now. If you have anything to say at all about this case and any of the material that we discussed, I would love to hear from you. Please drop a comment below. I would like to once again cite BSO, as well as the New York Times that wrote an article about this, as well as ESPN did an article as well that I would like to cite on the death of Fred Lane, the former running back for the Carolina Panthers. Until next time.